Good morning. It's so good to be here with you. Welcome to worship with Marlton United Methodist Church. And actually, if I'm correct, this is worship with everybody who tunes in. And I'm grateful all of you are here.
We pray for blessings, we pray for peace, comfort for family, protection while we sleep. We pray for healing, for prosperity. We pray for your mighty hand to ease our suffering. And all the while, you hear each spoken need. That love is way too much to give us lesser things. 'Cause what if your blessings come through raindrops? What if your healing comes through tears? What if a thousand sleepless nights are what it takes to know you're near? And what if trials of this life are your mercies in disguise? We pray for wisdom, your voice to hear. We cry in anger when we cannot feel you near. We doubt your goodness, we doubt your love. As if every promise from your word is not enough. And all the while, you hear each desperate plea. And long that we'd have faith to believe. 'Cause what if your blessings come through raindrops? What if your healing comes through tears? What if a thousand sleepless nights are what it takes to know you're near? And what if trials of this life are your mercies in disguise? When friends betray us, when darkness seems to win, we know the pain reminds this heart that this is not our home. It's not our home. What if your blessings come through raindrops? What if your healing comes through tears? What if a thousand sleepless nights are what it takes to know you're near? What if my greatest disappointments or the aching of this life is the revealing of a greater thirst world can't satisfy? And what if trials of this life, the rain, the storms, the hardest nights, are your mercies in disguise?
Please join me in prayer. Holy, mighty God, we ask that you pour your Holy Spirit down upon us now. Invade our hearts and our minds and the places where we worship, so that we may feel your warmth, that you will set us on fire, so that we may go and act on that which you teach us today. Amen.
All right, guys, it's time for the children's sermon. So if you want to come forward and sit a little closer to the TV, you can do that. If you want to sit on the other side of the room, you can do that. It's all up to you. Now, you may notice that I've never filmed in this spot before, but I'm actually in my backyard, or the parsonage's backyard right now. And it reminds me of what's going on now, because it was a beautiful day today. And it was sunny and nice, and we were called to stay inside because of the coronavirus. And so we couldn't go and play and do and all the things that we wanted to, which is important because we need to do that to keep one another safe. It seems like everything's turned upside down. And why not? There's a lot of things in life that are turned down. And honestly, as Christians, we should be used to being turned upside down. Today's scripture being a great place to look at it. You know, it starts off and it said, "Blessed are the poor." Now, if you haven't already heard it yet, you're likely going to hear from your teachers, from your parents, from society, that the whole goal is not to be poor, but to make money so that you can earn a living, so you can do the things that you want to do. And yet, this says, blessed are the poor. That's just confusing. Why would Jesus say such a weird thing? And he goes on and he talks about all of these opposites of things in the world. But the truth is, once again, as Christians, we shouldn't be surprised by this. You see, Jesus, when he was born into the world, he was born to be a king. And where was this king born? Well, he was born in a lowly manger. He was supposed to be a warrior, but he wasn't. He was a carpenter. He was supposed to fight for his people, and he died so that he might save us. You see, there's a big history of everything being turned upside down. And as Christians, we should be willing to embrace that. And the truth is, here's the truth. If you're lucky in your life, if you're honest with yourself, the truth is that just about more than anything else in the world, you want something so strong, so powerful, so amazing, that you know that you're supposed to do something weird and different and turn your life upside down. It worked out for Pastor Ann and I. We had a whole different career path, and we ended up being in the church. And it was the best thing we could ever do. Our lives were turned upside down, and Jesus made things right side up. It's crazy. But again, as Christians, we should be used to that. Let's pray. Great and loving God, thank you so much for being different, for turning our lives upside down, for pushing us and making us think differently about things. Lord, as we are able, turn our lives upside down. Make us to know and feel your love in a way that we've never felt before, in a way that makes us do crazy things for you. Lord, we love you and we praise you. It's in your name we pray. Amen. All right, guys, have a great week.
Our scripture lesson today comes from Luke 6, verses 20 through 26. Looking at his disciples, Jesus said, "Blessed are you who are poor, for yours is the kingdom of God. Blessed are you who hunger now, for you will be satisfied. Blessed are you who weep now, for you will laugh. Blessed are you when people hate you, when they exclude you and insult you and reject your name as evil because of the Son of Man. Rejoice in that day and leap for joy, because great is your reward in heaven. For that is how their ancestors treated the prophets. But woe to you who are rich, for you have already received your comfort. Woe to you who are well fed now, for you will go hungry. Woe to you who laugh now, for you will mourn and weep. Woe to you when everyone speaks well of you, for that is how their ancestors treated the false prophets." This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Lately, I find myself seeing both blessings and woes in our current lives. Things like staying at home makes me stir crazy, but it is keeping my neighbor safe, and aren't we called to love our neighbors? Having to cook every meal seems tedious at times, but we are saving money and eating more healthfully. My son's college graduation ceremony is canceled, but that gives us less time in a crowded auditorium and more time to celebrate as a family. The amount of Zoom meetings I have seem endless, but I don't have to commute back and forth to them. I miss seeing my friends, but I'm having unexpected time with my family. I imagine I'm not the only one who's feeling this way right now. The Gospels of Matthew and Luke each include the Beatitudes, the blessings, where Matthew's are all a list of blessed are. Luke includes both blessings and woes. Now you see, Luke is writing to the Gentiles, people less familiar with Jewish teachings. Gentiles are mostly accustomed to Greek or Hellenistic ways of thinking, things that are a dichotomy, one versus the other. And so that is what Luke is doing here. Let's put that idea to the test. Luke says, "Blessed are you who are poor, for yours is the kingdom of God. But woe to you who are rich, for you have already received your comfort." He says, "Blessed are you who hunger now, for you will be satisfied. But woe to you who are well fed now, for you will go hungry. Blessed are you who weep now, for you will laugh. But woe to you who laugh now, for you will mourn and weep." And then he says, "Blessed are you when people hate you, when they exclude you and insult you and reject your name as evil because of the Son of Man. Rejoice. In that day, you will leap for joy, because your reward is in heaven. For that is how their ancestor treated the prophets. But woe to you when everyone speaks well of you, for that is how their ancestors treated the false prophets." This is confusing, because it seems like Jesus is saying, woe to you for all of the things that are good in our lives. Let's think about this. Let's look a little bit deeper. You see, Jesus is not preaching to a crowd. He is speaking directly to his disciples. The scripture begins with, looking at his disciples, he said. So because Jesus is speaking to his disciples, the ones who are following him, who are with him during his ministry, he's calling his disciples to carry their cross and follow him, to truly give of themselves in order to hear and practice Jesus' teachings. Think about it this way. Imagine that there is a person who wants to learn how to swim. He takes a book, checks it out of the library, How to Swim. He reads every page, which talks about how to move your arms, how to breathe, everything there is to know about swimming. But he never jumps into the pool. Yet still he says, I'm an expert in swimming. I know how to swim. But he's never acted on his knowledge. So Jesus is asking his disciples not to be like this wannabe swimmer. He's asking them to hear and study Jesus' teachings, but not just hear them, act upon them. And so he's asking his disciples, he's actually telling his disciples, if you are poor, my friends, because you are giving away everything you have or leaving things behind, then you are following me. But if you are hoarding funds, you're not practicing what you appear to believe. If you are sharing food with those who are in need, you're hearing me. You're acting upon my teaching. But if you are keeping it all for yourself, you are not hearing and doing what I teach. If you weep for the sick and the hungry and the needy, you are hearing me. But if you laugh or dismiss or have no compassion on these people, you are not truly following me. Now, he also says, if people mock you because of the way you behave as you believe in me and listen to me, that's okay. It's going to be okay. Because if you were to try to fit in and sell yourself out, you will be miserable and your time with me will be useless. So he says all of these things to his disciples, but guess what? We are his disciples too. A disciple is a student, a follower. Now, if you're watching today, you are a disciple because you want to know who Jesus is and understand his teachings. You are studying, you are following, you are a disciple. And followers practice Jesus' teaching. And so I charge you, don't turn off your phone or your computer today and think, what nice music, what an interesting story about wannabe swimmers. No. Practice what Jesus said. Give, share, donate food for those who are food insecure. Have compassion on those in need and act accordingly. We see all sorts of these things happening in our world right now. People coming up with creative ways to give and to share and to appreciate and to have compassion on others. If people who don't know Jesus are doing this and we're sitting back, not doing but observing. We're not really following what our Lord has taught us. If people who don't know Jesus are doing that, shouldn't we, who love Christ, who are studying Christ, who are following Christ, do it all the more? If we are caring for others because we are disciples, then we're doing what Christians do. Part of being a Christian is doing, not just reading. Jump into the water, don't just read about it. Care. Act. Do. This is the way to follow our Lord. And all of God's disciples said, Amen. Please pray with me. Holy, mighty God, we thank you for the ability to worship together today. It is a blessing and an honor to praise you and to give you thanksgiving. Help us to take what you have taught us and live according to your word. Amen.
These are the days of Elijah, declaring the word of the Lord. And these are the days of your servant Moses, righteousness being restored. And though these are days of great trials, of famine and darkness and in the desert, crying, prepare the way of the Lord. Behold, he comes, riding on the clouds, shining like the sun, at the trumpet call. Lift your voice, it's a year of jubilee, and out of Zion till salvation comes. These are the deeds of your servant David, rebuilding a temple of praise. And these are the deeds of the harvest. The fields are as wide in the world. And we are the laborers in your vineyard, declaring the word of the Lord. Behold, he comes, riding on clouds, shining like the sun. At the trumpet call, lift your voice. It's a year of jubilee, and out of Zion till salvation comes. There's no God like Jehovah. 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 Behold.
Now receive this benediction. Care, act, do, for this is the way to follow our Lord. Amen.